So, folks, we begin a new period today. Yay! All right, let's give it up for period three. I don't know if you guys are fans of Baroque music. Mr. D is, you know. I used to be Baroque, but now I'm out of Monet. Okay, but anyway, Baroque music, that is George Friedrich Handel, a German composer who came with the new King of England, the Hanovers, to England. And this was part of music he did called the Saraband. It's often seen and used in dueling scenes in movies, so you probably heard that. And in a lot of ways, that's what this war is going to be. It's going to be a duel between the British and the colonists versus the Indians and the French. And we call this little war the French-Indian War. Now, let's look at the years. And Mr. D did not put this on your notes, but if you got a way to maybe type it in somewhere or to make notes the old school way, you know, paper, pen. Let's look at the year. 1754 begins this period. That year marks the beginning of the French-Indian War, a war that is completely going to change the relationship between the American colonists and the British, as well as with the Native American inhabitants. It's going to result in the French basically leaving North America. It is a big, big change. Some people go so far, y'all, and I've even had students answer this as an essay question before, why can the French-Indian War be called the war that made America? There was even a TV series on PBS called The War That Made America. And it basically said, if there's no French-Indian War, there isn't an American Revolution such as we know it. And so I will talk about the fighting. I'll talk about the background. That's all kind of interest that way. But the real thing AP wants you guys to get out of this is the results of this war, economically, politically, philosophically, socially, all those kind of things. And we'll go over that. Now, this period ends with 1800. Now, between 1754 and 1800, y'all, these are some of the events that happen. We have the French-Indian War, the culmination of these colonial wars. Changes the whole relationship, as I said. Then we have the steps leading to the revolution, as we call it, and or the War for Independence. Then we have that War for Independence. Then we have a real critical time after the war in which we replace one constitution, the Articles of Confederation, with another, the Constitution. We get that sucker ratified. Then we elect one president, George Washington, and then another president, John Adams. Now, Washington and Adams, y'all, were what we call Federalists. They were the first political party, things kind of began to fall apart. John Adams had been best buds with Thomas Jefferson when they had worked to write the Declaration of Independence and get America to accept independence. But very soon afterwards, they began to see the world very, very differently. Jefferson will go on to form his own political party, the Democratic Republicans, and Adams will embrace more this Federalist thing. And so their friendship comes to an end over politics. It's sad, but I mean, I don't know, once again, what your guys' political beliefs are. That's not Mr. D's business or whatever. But I know there are people that have lost friends over, you know, Trump and over Hillary and over Biden and all that. People that can't talk, even family members. And that's really sad when that happens, but it does. And it happened between Jefferson and Adams. So in 1800, y'all, Thomas Jefferson runs a very, very nasty campaign against John Adams. And he wins the election and Jefferson becomes president. Now, we're a young country at this point. We've only been around as far as having a constitution for 12 years, right? That's nothing, right? That's basically the time you guys were since kindergarten to the point where you are now, right? And a lot of people wonder, is America going to be like other countries? You know, whenever you have an election or you have one leader getting ready to leave, is he going to actually leave? Is he going to give up power peacefully? Are you going to have to get and kick the dude out of the White House? Because Adams was the first president to live in the White House. And it's interesting, y'all, because we've never, ever had those fears until this year. And once again, I try not to ever be political in this class, but it's interesting hearing this discussion where we're hearing people say, we started hearing some of it in 2016, but we're now hearing it in 2020. You know, if you don't win the election, Mr. Trump, if you don't win the election, Mr. Biden, are you going to accept the results? And both times, y'all, both presidents are not exactly saying they are. They're both kind of acting like they may fight it. And there's people who believe if it is Trump who loses, that he won't go peacefully. And others trying to say if it's Biden who loses, he's not going to accept it peacefully. And so, you know, that would be a perfect culmination of this crazy year, wouldn't it? If indeed that happens. And what's so sad is, y'all, we went through over 200 years, you know, 230 years without that kind of happening. And now it looks like we may have that argument all over again. The election of 1800 and the revolution that's called that followed it supposedly fixed that for us. And it did for over 200 years. Adams does leave peacefully. Jefferson takes over. But the revolution of 1800 that ends this period, y'all, is more than that. Because Jefferson doesn't just, you know, become president and change everything. And I got to say this about Adams. And I like Adams and I like Jefferson a lot, y'all. But in the election, they had basically painted Jefferson as almost like Satan, right? If you think this election is nasty, oh, ain't nothing compared to what they did in 1800 against each other. And so there were a lot of people, y'all, who believed when Jefferson became president, I mean, Bibles would be burned, you know, Satan would take over the office, you know, rape would become legal. I mean, it was crazy, and I'm not exaggerating. And yet Jefferson, y'all, surprised a lot of people. He kept most of the Federalist policies in place. He got rid of some of the stuff that people really hated. He modified a few things. But basically, he assured people, hey, if your guy doesn't win the presidency, we're still going to, things aren't going to change completely upside down. And that reassures people. And that's another thing that scares me about this 2020 election is the fact that a lot of people on both sides, Democrats and Republicans, are making this election where it's like all in. Like, if this guy wins, the world's going to come to an end. If this guy wins, the world's going to continue going down the tubes or something. And it's kind of sad to heat our emotions up like that and get us all going. No wonder friendships end if you do it that kind of way. Now, at least Jefferson and Adams became friends again before they ended. And this is awful, y'all, but they literally, this is the word they used, they renewed their epistolary intercourse. Now you go, Mr. D, what the heck? Epistolary intercourse is what they used to call y'all, and you guys do it every day. That's right. Letter writing or texting or emailing. Whenever you exchange letters or typing with each other, you guys are engaging in epistolary intercourse. And indeed, they again began to do that towards the end of their lives. And it's beautiful, y'all, to see two friends coming together, differing on politics, but at least, you know, realizing, man, we did some amazing things together back in the day. We started a country. How many people can say that? And we got it off to a pretty good doggone start kind of thing. So it's really neat to read that. And it's one of my favorite stories, y'all. And then to cope it all off, what do? They both die on exactly the same day, July 4th, 1826. Jefferson died before Adams. When Adams died, his last words were, Thomas Jefferson still lives. But in fact, Jefferson, who had willed himself to make it to the fourth, his last words were like, is it the fourth yet? And then he died, right? I mean, that is pretty awesome, right? You can't beat that. And that's real, man. I can't make that stuff up. And you couldn't put it in a movie and people wouldn't believe if you did. All right. So there we go, y'all. 1754 to 1800. A lot of stuff happens, but what makes it happen is this French-Indian War. So let's go and let's look at a chapter here that Mr. D has for y'all. Once again, I've had students actually respond to this as an essay, and I could absolutely see AP doing something like this. AP, y'all, will sometimes give you a quote, and they'll say, assess the validity of the following statement, or they'll say, to what extent is this statement true? Or to what extent do you agree or disagree with the following statement? So you have to look at it. And, you know, rarely are you going to completely agree with something, or rarely you're going to completely disagree with the statement. But you're going to either agree more than you disagree, or disagree more than you're going to agree. So one of the things I want you to keep in mind as I introduce this particular topic is this concept that this war makes America. Now, long after John Adams was president, okay, he's reflecting, right? He's looking back and people are asking him about the revolution. Like, man, tell us about the revolution, man. Tell us about the good old days. And he's like, what do you mean by the revolution? The war, you know, the people shooting each other? That was not part of the revolution. It was only an effect or consequence of the war. I mean, of it. So in other words, y'all, the revolution was something else. It's not us fighting and killing the British, right? And winning battles at Yorktown and stuff like that. No, in his mind, the revolution was in the hearts and the minds of the people. Okay, I got those reversed, just like Jefferson sometimes did. It was in the minds and the hearts. Okay, and this was affected. This happened between 1760 and 1775. That's why this is such a great AP topic, y'all. They even give you the parameters, the dates. So basically, what happens between 1760 and 1775, and that's what we're going to be doing today and what we'll be doing Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, that are going to lead up to that first shot that happens at Lexington and Concord, right? And he says, in the 15 years before a drop of blood was shed. So he really is basically saying, y'all, that the revolution, that's in the hearts and the minds. That's changing how Americans felt about the British and vice versa, by the way. We often only look at it one-sided. The real revolution, that's what it was, changing how we felt about each other, changing how we felt about government. And to make it happen, we just had to fight for it. So that's really what he's saying here. And I've always really, really liked that quote, y'all, when I first discovered it a few years ago. All right. So here's your key concept, just so you guys know that this is indeed part of AP. Britain's victory. Oh, spoiler alert, y'all. We win the French Indian War. Sorry about that. Britain's victory over France and the imperial struggle for North America, in other words, the French Indian War, led to new conflicts among the British government, the North American colonists, and the American Indians. So the Native Americans, y'all, they're going to be a loser in this war too, right? Sadly, Native Americans are about as successful as Mr. D is in presidential elections. You can usually tell who's going to win an election, y'all, by who Mr. D doesn't vote for. I mean, I have a really good record of voting for the person who loses. But anyway, Native Americans, it's kind of the same thing. Whatever side they're on tends to lose, and I hate to say that. Now, the North American colonists, they're going to change a lot because of this war. And of course, the British are going to change a lot too. And like I said, we often only look at from the colonist side. I'll give you guys the British side because their opinion of us changes a lot too. And all of this is going to result, y'all, in the creation of a new nation, the United States of America. And we should start, like, you know, playing the Star Spangled Banner at that point, but we don't have that. So what's your big ideas? Well, see how I made them bigger? There we go. And smaller at the same time. How did Native Americans' relationship with the colonists change? We're going to go over that as well too, y'all. We'll talk about how that happens because that too is going to help lead us to this thing that we usually call a revolution, the war for independence, right? And then also another one here is how did the colonist, and I put an extra apostrophe there, apologize for that. How did the colonist relationship with Britain change after the 7 years? And this is going to lead to Britain ending salutary neglect. Now, Mr. D will be using two terms interchangeably. I mean, there may be some people who disagree, but I like to use them interchangeably. Salutary neglect, benign neglect. Now, remember how Mr. D has talked a lot about how the British kind of left us alone? Unlike the French, unlike the Spanish, who were always interfering with their colonies, the British kind of left us alone. Now, that wasn't just because they were good guys or something. They had their own things going on. They had a civil war going on for quite a few of those years and that kind of thing. But regardless of why they let us alone, it was a good type of neglect. Salutary, salute, good thing. Benign, not going to hurt you, good thing type of neglect. By leaving us alone, we developed our own type of government. We got used to running things ourselves. And in a way, that's good, unless you get somebody who comes in and tries to change that policy. Just like you guys, if your parents whatever, for whatever reason, left you alone, let you do your own thing, pick your own jobs, come to school, do whatever, have your own girlfriends, boyfriends, let you pick your own clothes out, wash your clothes, cook your own meals, set your own hours, you might really like that. And you might really learn to become a very independent person who, when you go away to college, it ain't going to be anything because you already know how to do it. On the other hand, if your parents do everything for you, they don't let you ever have any choices, it's going to be a little bit more difficult when you go away. So the American colonists were prepared for independence, and they were preparing for independence the whole time. But what's going to happen is we're going to get a new evil stepdad who's going to come in, King George III. He's going to try to start coming up with new rules, and we are not going to like it, okay? And that is not going to go very, very well for us. Okay, so here's some overviews about the war, okay? Now, the Native Americans in this war aren't just going to pick one side or and stick with them. They're constantly going to be looking at different sides and deciding who to pick. Now, for the most part, most Indians stayed loyal to the French to various extent. We talked about why. The French were much nicer to them. French didn't come over in large numbers. The French intermarried with them. They didn't, you know, kill them or chase them away or whatever. So they stayed in good terms with it. But at the same time, the Indians are agents, right? They have agency. They're going to carefully look at what's going on, and maybe they might temporarily side with somebody else. Maybe they might back the United States government later on, or maybe not back it. Maybe they might back the French, or they might back the British, or they might just stay neutral. Now, and this is going to culminate ultimately in something we'll call Pontiac's War, but there's also our rebellion, and then there's even going to be a war after during the Revolution. There was two wars, y'all. There was the American Revolution. At the same time, we're also fighting Indians who were backing the British during the Revolution. Now, the key place where this is going to happen, y'all, is in the Ohio River Valley. I'll talk about that in just a sec. And this war will be called the French-Indian War. Now, I'm not going to get into all the previous little wars that happened. There's a Queen Anne's War. There's a King William's War. There is even a Queen Anne's War, or no, King George War as well, too, y'all. And these wars start over in Europe, and eventually they fight over here as well, too. But what you, those are really unimportant in the long run. It is, they are just like warm-ups, y'all. They are just like little sprints compared to this massive French-Indian War, which a lot of people now are calling, in some ways, the First World War. Not that it's the same war in 1914, but it's the first war, y'all, that is not just fought in Europe, not just fought in America. It's fought in Asia, too. It is fought all over this place, and it is a massive, massive war. A friend of mine, older than me, and I know you're like, older than you, Mr. D? I only thought rocks and maybe big trees in California were older than you, Mr. D. But no, he is working on a book. He spent 20 years on it, on the French-Indian War. I hope he can get it done because it is supposed to be awesome. Like 700 to 800 pages, a couple hundred pages of footnotes, you know, and sources. Should be awesome. But until then, we'll just have to rely on what we've already read or had people write about. Now, this war, y'all, remember, the French and Indians are the opponents. The Americans and the British are on one side. And you'll hear me say that about 10 times today. So if you don't get it, I don't know what to say. There is an exception. For the most part, the League of the Iroquois, the League of the Five Nations, whatever you want to call it, the Iroquois Confederation, for the most part, they were either neutral or they supported the British, especially, y'all, when the war starts going the British way. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, people who were watching the NBA finals last week, you know, which ultimately, spoiler alert, LA wins. So let's say you're watching and LA's up 3 games and you're suddenly like, yeah, I'm going to root for LA now. Well, yeah. They're up 3 games. Of course, you're rooting for them. They're going to win. You know, you're hopping on the bandwagon at the end. The Iroquois kind of did that. They kind of watched. They didn't want to support the French, but they didn't necessarily want to support the British. But when they see the British winning, it's like, ooh, we better get in on this, right? And maybe we can get some stuff out of this war, okay? So you have that. All righty. And we're going to go to the next slide. It just takes a while to come up here. So the first thing to talk about, y'all, that comes out of this war happens kind of during it, although, and it's related to it, but it's not physically part of the war, is what's called the Albany Plan of Union. Now, Mr. D is going to put up a hip use video for you guys. Make a note of that, Mr. D. Hip use video. Put it up later. Where he goes over this much better than Mr. D can or will. And he talks about it in some more detail. And I urge you to watch it. It's 5 minutes or something. But anyway, notice Albany. That is what is today the capital of New York. So it's up New York, up the Hudson River there. And it's a plan of union, trying to bring at least some of the colonies together. And it happens just when this war is going, 1754. Now, they had been worried, y'all, and this is so often the case, right? I mean, I've got great neighbors. One of the reasons I stay where I am is because of my great neighbors. We talk to each other all the time. But, you know, some people, they don't really know their neighbors until, like, there's a hurricane. And suddenly you got to start talking to these people and working together and getting rid of all the trees and doing that. And you finally meet your neighbors. Well, in some ways, that's kind of what happens with these colonies. They're very different. In a lot of cases, they don't like each other. And the only way you can get them together is some sort of external threat. I mean, once again, it'd be like if aliens came here and suddenly it was us, humans, or them, you know, the people with or whatever they are with multiple arms and 20 eyes or whatever. We would like hopefully decide, you know, our problems with Russia and China aren't as big as our problems with, you know, these people attacking us. And we might all come together and unite. So that's essentially what happens, y'all. Colonies decide to put aside their differences and to try to create a mutual defense pact where they can work together to protect each other. And also, they're very worried about the Iroquois. If they can't get the Iroquois on their side, they at least want to keep the Iroquois neutral and not let them start supporting the French. So it's a key thing to keep the Iroquois happy. Now, as you'll see, it does not pass. Sadly, what happens is it does get passed by the delegates. Now, as we'll see, only 7 colonies showed up, and Mr. D will go over those, who was there, who wasn't there, and why. But ultimately, when this plan is sent back home to the individual colonies' legislatures, they all turn it down. When it's sent over to Britain, the British turn it down. And we'll go over the reasons for that. But one of them has to do with taxes. Now, AP sometimes, y'all, likes to ask you guys, what were the major reasons of the revolution? Was the American Revolution primarily an economic thing? Was it primarily a political thing? Some people even go, was it a religious thing? Okay. But if you're going the economic route, you can use the tax thing. Of course, you can also use it as a political thing, as I'll explain. But a lot of people rejected it because they don't like taxes going up. I mean, who likes to like vote for me? I'll raise your taxes. Oh, yeah, sure, buddy. Yeah, you're getting my vote, right? So this was going to increase taxes. It would have to if you're going to prepare for war. Also, the colonists might lose some of that power to decide what kind of taxes they were having to pay. So some of the colonists, y'all, saw this as, hey, you're increasing my taxes. You're taking away some of my taxing power. Why should I vote for this? But, you know, the guys who wrote it had to be kind of careful. If they went too far, they knew the British would reject it. There's no way they can declare their independence. The British aren't just going to put up with that. So the guys who write it have to be realistic, what we call pragmatic, right? But it turned out they tried to please everybody. And what happens if you try to please everybody, y'all? You don't please anybody, not even yourself. All right, so here we go. And you guys are to get to see the first political cartoon here, we believe, in American history. And this is done by Ben Franklin. I mean, after all, Ben Franklin is everywhere. He's doing all these things. So Ben Franklin is at the Albany Conference, y'all, where they come up with this plan of union. It is mainly New England, that is Connecticut, Rhode Island, and Massachusetts. And New Hampshire. So you got those 4, Connecticut, Rhode Island, Massachusetts, New Hampshire. And then you got New York, Maryland, and Pennsylvania. Now, Maryland is the only kind of Southern or Chesapeake colony there. Notice it is only the colonies and the top part of the future United States. I mean, it just took, it would take too long to get the people down in the South to know. And even if they found out, it ain't like today where you hop on a plane and you're there in a couple of hours. It takes weeks. So basically, y'all, this is just like the North, okay, being there. Now, so Ben Franklin draws this cartoon. So let's evaluate this cartoon. First of all, a key thing to look at is what? The join or die, the caption, right? We call that the caption, the message. And notice how he phrases it. Join, comma, that means pause, right? Join or die. And this is just so typical. I hate to say it of our media, y'all. You know, our media is always like, there's only two choices here, you know? There, you can't just pick somewhere in the middle. You either join us or you're going to die. And so he is really trying to scare people, but maybe with good reason. Now let's start analyzing this object. And what is the object, y'all? It's a snake, right? So let's cut the snake into pieces. All right. What do you think the N-E on this snake means? Anybody? Bueller? N-E. Who was there? New England. New England. And it's no accident, y'all. New England is the head. It's the brain. It's the fangs. Obviously, he considers New England to be the most important. That's the type of deeper analysis AP likes to see. Just not like, well, it's a snake and it's cut up and those are the colonies. And now he does do them from north to south, right? And maybe Mr. D is reading this into it. But AP would rather see you guys attempt to read something into it that may not be there than to not even try, okay? Let's look at another piece here. Next to it, NY, New York, right? Then what do we got? NJ, New Jersey, right? Then we got Pennsylvania. I mean, only one letter, y'all. He could have at least given us PA or PEN, but he gives us a P. And then below we see an M for Maryland. And then here, ironically, Virginia. Virginia is like twisted. I don't know what he's saying by that, y'all. Virginia's messed up. Virginia's wrapped up. You know, Virginia doesn't know what to do. I don't know. And then finally, we get North Carolina and we get South Carolina. Anybody know what colony he left off? That's right. I heard somebody. Georgia, Mr. D. Yes, that is correct. Georgia is the colony that he left off. Georgia is so unimportant, y'all, and it doesn't have anybody there that he doesn't include it. You know, I had a student one time say, well, maybe it's like, you know, the snake poop or something over here or something. I'm like, well, whatever, you know. But Georgia doesn't even count, y'all. So he only gives us 12 colonies. Now, the thing is, y'all, this Congress is going to fail. All right? The Congress is going to fail. And I thought I had a little failure thing pop up here. Let's see. There we go. Good job, Mr. D. So it fails. Remember why? It's partially covered here, y'all. I'll try to get rid of that. There we go. It gives too much independence, said the British. They didn't want the Americans going for independence. They saw this as too close to independence. But the colonists said, no. It's not enough independence. You're taking away our right to determine our voting. So why is this whole Albany plan significant? It is really the first large attempt outside of New England to have colonial unity. Now, if you remember after the Pequot War, the colonists on their own had formed the New England Confederation, but it didn't include Rhode Island and was only, you know, the little two colonies of Connecticut and the two colonies of Massachusetts. And then later, the colonists had been forced to be part of something called the Dominion of New England that the British had imposed on them, mainly so they could collect taxes and enforce the Navigation Acts. Colonists didn't like that, and as soon as England had a revolution in 1688 that chased out James II, the colonists chased out the leader of the Dominion of New England, Andros, and he was chased out of power. So the colonists had not been very happy or successful trying to be something more than individual colonies. This is the first effort. And then what again is salutary, or as Mr. D calls it, benign neglect? The British, just like some parents, let the colonies develop on their own. As long as the colonies kept making money for the motherland, they were pretty happy. They ignored a lot of stuff, y'all. They ignored us flagrantly violating the Navigation Acts. They ignored a lot of stuff. But we were making money. Nobody was really getting hurt. They let us do it while the British did their own thing. But this war and a new king are going to come together, and they're going to end that salutary neglect. And the British are going to be, as I say so often, like a new stepmom, a new stepdad who's going to step in and try to change how the colonies have been ruling themselves. And just like you guys would, if you've been given all this freedom and somebody comes around and tries to change the rules on you, we're going to rebel. And it's going to lead to us becoming our own separate country. All right, so here's a map. North America, 1750. I think on the notes I put 1754, but here it is, North America in 1750. As you can see, the Brits control the eastern seaboard, as well as Newfoundland and what will become be called Acadia. They eventually, we'll talk about that. Here is New France, right? New France covers all of the what is later the Louisiana Purchase. And notice there is an in-between land, the disputed land between the Appalachians and the Mississippi River. That is what this war is going to be all about, y'all, and what the American Revolution, to a lesser extent, is going to be about. And then you got the Spanish, who control what is Mexico today, Baja California, and you even have some Russians up here, sneaky Russians coming into Alaska. And then you got all of this. So that is the way the world, or at least the Western Hemisphere, looked. And notice this place, the Ohio River Valley, because that's where it's all going to start. This is where Mr. D was supposed to go this summer, y'all, to Louisbourg. And stupid Corona messed it up. I didn't get to go. But anyway, 1754, y'all, is when this war is going to start. Now, the first clash, the first time these forces are going to come together, y'all, is going to be over the Ohio River Valley. And there we go. Now, this area particularly was being disputed. The French claimed it. The British claimed it. There were colonists who actually owned land over here and who wanted that land. And if the French have it, they aren't going to have it. So what they do, y'all, is they ask this young militia guy. Okay, and I mean, he's like 21 or so, 22. And he's a pretty young guy, but man, he has aspirations to be much more. You might have heard his name, George Washington. He's just a kid. And they send George Washington with a handful of guys to try to talk the British, or to talk the French, into giving up this fort up here called Fort Duquesne.
This is gonna
be cool. And so remember, the war, British and American colonists versus French and Indians. Here it a second time. Okay. And here you go. For a third time. Remember, it is the British and American colonists and the Iroquois to a lesser extent versus the French and most of the Indians. We call this war after our opponents, right? It's like, for example, in American history, we talk about the Mexican War. Now, that war was between the United States and Mexico. Mexico has a different war for it. I think they call it the War of Northern Aggression or something like that. You know, people might call the Spanish-American War the Spanish War. You often name them after who you're fighting, and that's the case in this war. All right? Remember, it's not the French versus the Indians. I get that from students so much, so you guys aren't going to do that to Mr. D unless you're just trying to tick him off on purpose. All right, so here's the guy who started the war. See if you recognize him. It is George Washington. Yeah, one of my favorite paintings here, right, of George. I loved it when I got to see that thing in Lexington, Virginia, up close and real. There he is. This painting was actually done just after the war. Washington had distinguished himself in this war, y'all. He thought he was on his way to becoming what he wanted to be most in life. I kid you not, a general in the British Army, because that's where the money was. That's where the fame was, right? And he really thought that's where he was headed. But he is going to get turned down on that, and that's going to be to make the revolution very personal to him. All right, so Washington, y'all, is sent to tell the French to get out of this place. This is called Fort Duquesne. Now, you know how the French are, y'all, and I love French, y'all. We're watching a French TV series, and it's great because I'm picking up my French again and everything. But the French call this Duquesne. It looks to me like it's Duscany, you know, but they pronounce it Duquesne. And this is an amazing fort. Notice they cleared all the trees here. This is water here. This is a river here coming together at a point. They got a clear range of fire. People attack them from the water. They can shoot them. People attack them from here. They got plenty of room to get them. No place for their enemy to hide. Very, very effective, as the French were with stationary positions, you know, fortifications. They were excellent at that kind of stuff. Now, this place has changed a little bit since then. See the point? This is where Fort Duquesne used to be. When I visited this place a few years ago, I got to see the ruins of Fort Duquesne, or as it later became known, Fort Pitt. And this is actually from the top of the hill that you take an inclinator. It's kind of like an elevator that goes on its side up to the top of the hill. Look at all the bridges. Look at this amazing town. Here's another view. This is coming straight at what used to be Fort Duquesne. And what is this place today? It's called Pittsburgh. And it's supposed to play some music, but it didn't there. Now, as Washington is making his way, y'all, to Fort Duquesne, he runs in, and like I said, he's a young guy. He has no real military experience. He's just a guy who's practiced being in the army, you know, learning how to fire the gun and everything. He's got some money, so he's got a reputation for that. And he's got a handful of men with him, as well as a few Indians, okay? A few of these Indians. One of these Indians is called Half King. It's kind of too complex to get in here. But Half King, y'all, wants to start a war, right? And he is going to help Washington start this war. So as they're making their way towards Fort Pitt, or Fort Duquesne, what's going to become Pitt and Pittsburgh, they run into a group of Frenchmen. Now, Washington jumps the gun, so to speak, literally. Without really much warning, he opens fire on these Frenchmen, wounding and killing a few. And then he captures the French leader. The man's name is Jumonville. Now, at this very rock, right here, y'all, at this rock, Washington sits down with the wounded Jumonville, and he's basically talking to him, and Jumonville gives him some bad news. Jumonville goes, young man, you just fired on a French diplomatic group. We are diplomats. We are not soldiers. You may have started a war. And Washington's like, oh, man, I blew it today. But before he can finish that thought, here comes Half King. And Half King comes up, y'all, right behind Jumonville on that very rock. And he says, je ne pas mort, mon père, right? Which is my bad French, basically, is you have not died yet, my father. Because the French were often called father. And later American leaders will be called father by some of the Indians. And he hits him on the head, y'all, and he splits his head open. And I kid you not, Half King reaches in and he pulls out the brain of Jumonville. This is going to set things in motion, y'all. And let's just say it this way, George has got some splaining to do. And if you look right here, y'all, you can still see some of the blood and break. No, you can't. They cleaned it off. But there you go. So it's on, like Donkey Kong. We got the French Indian War. Mr. D, we'll stop there, y'all. Okay, y'all. So when we stopped last at the end of the video I made yesterday, we were talking about how this war started. George Washington, this young militia man, is sent there, and he ends up inadvertently starting what would become a world war. Half King, an Indian who is with him, murders a French diplomat and the leader of a party that George Washington had fired upon. And as I said, right here, and the diplomat Jumonville is telling Washington what a mistake he has made. Washington is shocked when Jumonville is murdered right there. Half King comes up with a tomahawk, hits the guy in the head, shatters his brain after saying, you know, you are not yet dead, my father, and pulls the brain out. Now, George Washington is in trouble. He is not only fired on the French, but he has had a French prisoner, you know, a high-ranking prisoner killed under his protection. So George has some splaining to do. All righty. And we just so happen to have rare historical footage of that very thing.
To be fair, Washington is only 22. Ambitious and a little naive, he doesn't realize he's about to become a pawn in a chess game he doesn't understand.
Do you see the Frenchman?
Washington's orders are to drive the French from this contested part of the frontier with force if necessary. He doesn't know these French soldiers are on a diplomatic mission.
There's Half King. Les Anglais, the English.
The young major doesn't take the time to find out what the French are after.
Fire!
Okay, so I'm going to let you see this. Washington actually says there was something he found interesting about the bullets being fired, you know, near him. So here you see afterwards, he realizes, man, I'm in trouble. This guy is a Frenchman. And so let's let you see this scene here.
That this deep in the woods, different rules apply.
Tu n'es pas encore mort, mon père.
Ow, man. They don't show you him taking out the brain, but Washington's like, oh my God, you just killed the guy and took his brains out.
The half king has his own agenda. Within minutes, the Half-King's warriors plunder the French camp, scalping the dead and wounded before they leave.
Now, so after starting the war between the French and the Americans and British,
not an outcome Washington expected.
They
nor
leave.
Could he have foreseen the consequences.
All right, so there you go. So what Washington's going to do now that he has basically no support, he does get some British who come to his aid. But he decides, man, the French are going to come after me big time. And indeed, Jumonville, who was killed, was the brother of the French commander at Duquesne. But nevertheless, the guy could be quite humane to Washington. So what Washington does, y'all, is he instructs his men to build a little fort out there not too far away from where Jumonville had been killed. And this is it. I mean, I don't know about y'all, but man, when I was a kid, I think we built better forts. And here, like you see one of the like the little cannons that they might have had. Now, when you look at this fort, which they called Fort Necessity, and that makes me think of the bathroom because people used to say, I got to go answer the necessary or, you know, take care of the necessary. That's kind of what it looks like here. But anyway, look at it, y'all. The enemy can hide in these trees. This is in a low-lying area. There's not very good drainage, and Washington is going to find that all out. And so very quickly, without Indian allies, he is going to be attacked by the French and their Indian supporters. Mr. D just so happens to have rare historical footage about that.
Meanwhile, Washington has withdrawn his men to a large meadow. They build a crude stockade that the Virginians wryly name Fort Necessity. Washington expects the Half-King to help defend the fort. But the Indian leader has lost confidence in the young major.
I don't know why. He's done such a great job so far.
He's a good-natured man, but he has no experience. Always driving us to fight by his direction. Now he wants us to make a stand with him against the French. That little thing upon the meadow.
Washington's only Indian ally leaves.
We have no choice. We will make our stand here.
All right, so eventually the French are going to come after them, right? And here you just see some of it. The French are just shooting at them from the trees. It's just absolutely awful, but it's about to get worse because guess what happens? The rain comes. Now their gunpowder's going to get wet.
We filled our trenches with water and wet not only the ammunition and the firelocks, but also the few stores that we had, leaving us only a few bayonets for defense.
By nightfall, the situation is hopeless. When the French commander offers terms for surrender, Washington signs the soggy document.
But there's a problem.
Unable to read French, he relies on a Dutch officer to translate.
So the Dutch guy knows English and French.
It turns out that Julenville's brother is taking a sweet revenge. Washington doesn't learn until later that the document includes a confession to the assassination of Ensign Jumonville. The morning after the battle, the victorious French allowed Washington to retreat towards Virginia with his wounded and tattered troops. Word of his defeat spread quickly. This was not the kind of fame the young Washington had been seeking. The date, oddly enough, was the 4th of July, 1754.
There you go. So Washington ends up surrendering on a day. In fact, he says, July 4th is the worst day of my life. Not knowing, of course, that 16 years later, or yeah, try to do the math, Bob. 12 years later, it will be one of the most important years of his life when, of course, the Declaration is signed on that day. Now, as a result of this embarrassment and the fact that Washington now is painted as the starter of the war, the British decide, okay, we got to take care of this problem with the French once and for all. We got to eliminate their presence there. And they send over a general. I've never quite understood. I was asking my friend, we were talking about this the other day, why did they think so highly of Braddock? And I guess he had connections or whatever. Braddock was basically an untested soldier or general. He was very wealthy. And so everybody thinks, man, Braddock is this tough guy. He's going to come over. He's going to teach the French a real lesson. So they bring over Braddock. He comes over with several thousand troops, and he is going to show everybody how to fight these French, that these stupid Americans don't know how to fight the French. And so he's going to get rid of them there. He has a very, very low opinion of a militiaman like George Washington, who aren't professional soldiers, who were kind of like National Guard people who maybe once or twice every month practice being soldiers. So, but he takes them along because they know the route. So he brings along George Washington and some of George's buddies. But what happens is just a few miles away from Fort Duquesne, once again, they don't make it to Fort Duquesne, Indians and Frenchmen and French militiamen, Canadians, surprise them and attack them. Now, this is often portrayed as an ambush, but it really wasn't. Basically, the French are coming down a road, the British are coming down a road, and the American and British forces, y'all, because of all the trees and stuff, they are really, really drawn out in a very, very long line. And so what the French are going to do is, as you'll see in the video, they're going to use some of their people to hold up the British and keep them from moving forward. And then they're going to send their Indians and militiamen along the sides into the trees and lay down fire that way, as well as going to the very back. Now, in the very back, you had a lot of women, or as they were called, camp followers. Now, indeed, some of these women might have been prostitutes, but a lot of them were sweethearts. They were sisters. They were even mothers and stuff of some of the soldiers. And they came along to cook for them, to do clothes for them, or they were just women who needed to make a living. And so they're going to come down, the Indians, particularly hard on these women, and they're going to kidnap them and maybe exchange them for things later on. So I happen to have some rare historical footage of that.
Fort Duquesne, Braddock's first objective, is held by the French and their Indian allies. It stands guard at the crucial forks, controlling...
I'm going to go forward here a little bit. And so you see Braddock and his men, and they only go like 22 miles in I forget how many days, because they are cutting trees. They are making their way. They're basically making a giant road. And there you see the ladies in the back and everything like that. And then when the French get word that they are coming, right? And this is a year later. Everything goes really slow. Remember, Washington surrendered July 4th, 1754. This is a year later. So Washington and his men are making way there. So here we see one of the French commanders coming out. And what's interesting is the French commander, to rally his Indians, he took off his French clothes and dressed as an Indian to show his support. Once again, you wouldn't see a British general doing that.
It's impossible to say who is more surprised when they encounter each other deep in the woods.
And notice how the British are dressed.
British grenadiers move forward.
But they're going to be kind of stuck by their tactics, where they all stay together. They shoot together. They shoot at the same time. And they will not go into the woods and break up their units to go after the Indians and the French militiamen. Now, so here comes the Frenchman, his Indian allies. And you see, not that many French soldiers. They just didn't have the people.
He'll fight the battle the Indian way. In the beginning, it looks as if the highly disciplined British will prevail. Their volleys prove deadly immediately. Beaujeu is one of the first to fall. But once the Indians and Canadians slip into the hills on either side of the British, everything changes. Washington and the other officers struggle to keep their men in formation.
I mean, you're just having to sit there and be shot at. And Washington starts begging, as you guys will see, like, let us take, General Braddock, let us take our men into the woods and fight them.
Are deployed in front of the British column, blocking any forward movement.
Remember, these guns can only fire once, and then you had to spend 30 seconds or so reloading it.
Snipe at them from both sides.
You can't hit anybody up there. Your cannons are useless.
The British start to fall back, but on the narrow forest road, they collide with the troops behind them.
See, here's all the cannons and stuff. It's not very useful.
Deadly tangles of redcoats massed together, making pathetically easy targets. The artillery proves useless in the dense woods.
So one by one, like I said, they're getting knocked off, and Washington is begging them. And finally, this happens, the inevitable. General Braddock gets shot. Braddock goes down. And for some reason, somebody's singing in the woods. Now, despite Braddock being such an awful officer, Washington absolutely adored him. That is the type of general he wants to be someday, at least a British general.
To reach the rear of the British column.
He will keep the sash for the rest of his life that he took from there. And when Braddock dies, ironically, y'all, Braddock will say the American militiaman had fought better than his own troops.
Of the 54 women who marched with Braddock's army that day, only 4 returned.
No!
Some of the missing would turn up in Canada, ransomed from the Indians by the French. After 3 harrowing hours, it's over. The French and Indians have lost only 21 dead, while nearly 1,000 British and provincial soldiers are killed or wounded. Washington has had several horses shot out from under him.
But never was wounded. He never would be either.
What's left of Braddock's army makes a desperate retreat.
Now, this is where Washington really does a great job. He leads them together. He gets the army together.
None to be described.
And he really thought he deserved some credit for what he had done, but the British won't give him any.
The dying, the wounded, the groans, the lamentation, the cries of the wounded for help along the road were enough to pierce a heart of adamant.
Now, when Braddock dies, they'll bury him in the road.
The folly.
And they'll drive over it multiple times to keep the Indians from doing anything bad to the body.
Against the manner of the Indians fighting in the woods, which had in a manner been predicted.
So they really learn, y'all, that the Indian techniques are going to be better in this. And that's going to be something that's going to be important later on in how the Americans fight the British. So that's an important thing that they've already learned, is how to fight in this new type of land. In America, where you have all these trees, you have primitive roads and things like that. So they learned that lesson the hard way. And here's just a painting here that shows you some of that. With the defeat of Washington's forces in Braddock, you basically have the frontier left open. And Indians are going to begin a series of raids. Remember, the Indians are on the French side, terrorizing a lot of the pioneers, the Scottish. The Scotch-Irish and stuff, for example, out on the frontier are going to find themselves being ruthlessly attacked during this time. Now, it's 1756. The war has been going on since 1754, but finally, the British and the French get around to declaring war. Now, the war is later going to be called the Seven Years' War. Why is it called Seven Years' War, not the beginning, Mr. D? Well, because they didn't know, Forrest, that the war was going to last 7 years. You don't see any headlines like, 7 years war begins today. And remember, British and Americans versus French and Iroquois, the Native Americans are going to play off both sides. They're going to try to get the best deal possible that they can. Now, during and before the war, it actually had started in a previous war, but it continues during this war, people known as Acadians are expelled. Now, what you see here, y'all, is a map of Acadia. It's this little peninsula that sticks out of what is today called New Brunswick, out of Canada. And you see a couple islands here, Cape Breton Island, Prince Edward Island. And the French had built a fort called Louisbourg up here. And the colonists in an earlier war had actually captured it. But in the negotiations, the British had made the colonists return this fort, and it really angered them because a lot of colonists had died getting the fort. Well, the British decide we can't have the French up there anymore. These French are right on the St. Lawrence River or the Gulf of St. Lawrence. They're controlling what gets in and out of Canada. So they do what today might be called ethnic cleansing. They get rid of the French citizens. They literally require them to leave from Acadia. Many of them, some will go to Haiti, some will go over to Europe, but those that go to Louisiana quickly start calling themselves Acadians, or as we shorten it, Cajun. So if any of you have any Louisiana background, and my parents and a lot of my family and friends are from that area once upon a time, definitely are Cajuns. And Acadia changes its name and becomes known as Nova Scotia. And this is where it is. Mr. D was supposed to visit, as I said, up here, Louisbourg, as you can see right here on Cape Breton Island. Been to Halifax a lot. Halifax, by the way, y'all, is where a lot of the victims, people who died on the Titanic, their bodies were recovered not that far away and brought back and are buried there. There's even a grave for a Jay Dawson, which a lot of young people think is, of course, Jack. Come back, Jack. Don't give up, Jack. And so they'll put flowers and stuff there. And I try to tell them when I'm visiting, like, that's not Jack Dawson. That's like another guy. He was an engineer. But they don't ever believe me. But whatever. It makes them happy. Okay? Now, another event that's going to happen is the massacre at Fort William Henry. Now, what had been going on there, y'all, is for some time the French had surrounded this fort. And the British and American colonials in this fort, and including quite a few of their wives and women and family and all of that, They had been enduring this pounding of mortars. The French had gradually made trenches, kind of anticipating like World War One. They'd made these trenches and gradually got closer and closer, and they were starving them out with the siege. And they were firing these mortars that would go way up in the air and come down and hit them. And finally, the British commander decides, Colonel Monroe decides, I'm going to have to surrender. I can't lose all these women and children. And he makes a deal with the Frenchmen. The French under General Montcalm basically say, look, if you go, we'll even let you take your guns, but you're going to have to march to Fort George, quite a few miles away. And there you have to promise never to fight again. Now, this was called paroling. You would parole people, and the punishment was quite severe. If you got caught after being paroled fighting again, you could pay a very heavy price. And so basically, we're letting you go if you promise never to fight again. And so they're paroled and they're allowed to march away. Now, here is the fort. It's been reconstructed today. Now, the Indians, y'all, had been promised war booty. Booty. Anyway, and what that meant was they were promised that once the fort fell and these people were captured, they could take what they want, whether that's women, whether that's food, whether that's alcohol, guns, whatever. But they were going to get war booty. But instead, when the British are going to be allowed to leave and take all that away with them, they get angry. And they get angrier because that night, the British and French, now that they're not fighting, they sit down and they have a big party, right? And the British are drinking their beer and the French are drinking their wine and everybody is partying. And guess who's not invited? The Indians. So the Indians are getting angrier and angrier. So what happens, y'all, is as the after the British make their way forward, and indeed, mainly the British Army guys are in front. This is not exactly portrayed correctly in the film, but they march up front. It's mainly women and children towards the back. And the Indians are going to come out of the woods, and they are going to attack and massacre many, many of them. Now, it has been definitely exaggerated in history to where you think hundreds, if not thousands, of British were killed. A lot of the women are returned ultimately for money or whatever. But it does get really blown out of proportion, and it becomes a rallying cry. In some ways, it's kind of like an Alamo. You know, a lot of Texans forget that Texans lost the Battle of the Alamo. But what happens is it really brings Texans together, Texans who want revenge against the Mexican troops of Santa Ana who did this, and it's going to allow the great victory at San Jacinto that guarantees Texas independence, right? And so this really kind of backfires on the French to a certain extent. Now, the big question in history is, did the French know that this was going to happen and they just let it happen? Or was this out of their hands? Well, I'm just going to let you see the rare historical footage, because this will be from a movie called The Last of the Mohicans. Now, The Last of the Mohicans is one of the earliest American novels. Remember how we talked about Americans really didn't write that good of books that anybody read? Well, James Fenimore Cooper had heard that, and he was griping about that. And his wife's like, if you don't like it, why don't you write your own book? And he's like, okay, I will. And the book is not very pleasant to read today. If you guys know Mr. Park of Dobie News, JFD TV, he absolutely hates the guy. But he does become the first famous American writer. And his book is called The Last of the Mohicans, one of the first novels set in America, published in America, with real American characters. And it's been made into movies, it's been made into series, but the best movie, and Mr. D used some of this in his wedding, he used a lot of movie music in his wedding, that's just how I roll. Now, the turning point of this war, y'all, is going to become when William Pitt becomes the prime minister in 1757. Now, had somebody like Pitt been in control of Britain sooner, or maybe at the time of the Revolution, we might not have had one. He really understands the colonial concerns, the fact that they feel like they're not being treated fairly, the fact that they're having to pay for this war and not getting any of the money back. And so he's going to offer a compromise. You know, he is going to focus the British forces on North America and not the West Indies and not Europe. He's going to let his allies deal with that. And he's going to offer the Americans a compromise. Britain will reimburse, in other words, will pay back the colonial assemblies for their cost in the war. If the colonists will just pay the taxes to pay for this war, he will see to it that Britain pays those colonists back. And as a result, colonial morale is going to increase a great deal within the next year. And it's really going to make a turning point in the war. It's going to be the tide turns. He's going to send over a new general who is going to retake that fort that I told you up on Cape Breton Island, Louisbourg. And then that man will make his way in and go after the French fort at Quebec. General Forbes, another general he sends, is going to take what Washington had not been able to do, Fort Duquesne. And of course, it will be renamed Fort Pitt in honor of William Pitt, who had done this. And so we're going to end with this, y'all. The war is not going too well. But for whatever reason, in 1761, the Spanish decide to join up with the French. This will benefit them in some ways, but it's also going to cost them. So we'll stop here, y'all, the end of part two. I will put together part three for you guys, and that will take us through the results of the war. You'll see the final Battle of Quebec. We'll go over the different tactics and things, and we'll also talk about Pontiac's rebellion. And we'll get this all done. And we'll move on to the causes leading to the American Revolution. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your interest. Thank you for your patience filling this out. And I hope you enjoyed some of the great, rare historical footage. All right, take care, y'all.
Here we go. Now, the British and the Americans have been allowed to leave Fort William Henry. Remember, the Indians are furious. And it's not really explained in the part I gave you here. But this one particular Indian there that's leading them, he'd had his family wiped out. Yeah. There's Colonel Monroe's two hot daughters. Yeah, the good old British tactics of firing in volleys, you know. Notice there's only a handful of Indians on the side of the Brits. Now he's being held because he helped some of the Americans who wanted to get back to their homes because they had been promised they could always get back in time to protect their homes from the French and the Indians. But the British had denied that, so he helped some of them escape, and that's why that character Hawkeye, who's kind of a mixture of Native American and white, or an adopted member of the Mohican Indians. Now that's Colonel Monroe. He's the guy who had that guy's family killed in an earlier attack. Now if you watch the whole excerpt, it's pretty gross what happens to Colonel Monroe, so you can watch that part on your own. It's embedded into Schoology, so you can pull it up. You see how much smoke those old guns used to make, right? Maybe we should have sold the Indians those muskets, is what they're thinking. Even for all those beaver pelts. Hawkeye manages to get free. So this has gone down in history as a massacre, okay, and has been really exaggerated. Now, you can watch the whole thing on there on YouTube or on the Schoology thing. Maybe I can give you the link on YouTube and it might work better. All right. So with all of these disasters, it's really no surprise that a new prime minister comes to power. His name is William Pitt, and he turns out to be a very popular prime minister. He really changes the whole thing about the war. He starts focusing on winning the war in North America, where it started, thanks to George Washington, and not fighting in Europe, not fighting in the West Indies nearly as much. He knows this is where it's to be. Plus, a lot of Americans, y'all, have been very ambivalent and not big supporters of this war. A lot of the American legislators would not pass new taxes on their people to pay for this war. Some colonists, y'all, were even accused of offering, trading with the French, trading with the Indians during this war. So to try to get American support, he offers the Americans a compromise. Britain will reimburse, that is, they will pay back the colonial legislatures, the colonial assemblies, for all costs of this war. Now, later we won't be too happy when how the Brits come up with a way to pay for this war, which is to tax the Americans and not to give Americans ideas on how they'll do it. But at the time, this seemed like a really good idea. And the result, y'all, is colonial morale and morale for the Brits really changes. And the war, the tide really changes for this war. And so it begins to go well. Now, he will pick two very successful generals. He'll send over thousands of well-trained troops to win the war in North America. And so you can say that the tide turned. This will probably come on way too loud. I apologize. Well, there we go. See the tide turning? That was the lovely Deborah Harry of Blondie. Still have a crush on her 40 years later. But anyway, the general that he sends over is James Wolfe. Now, remember this area just north of Nova Scotia, former Acadia. He takes Louisbourg, right? Wolfe takes that place, which gives him now access to entering the St. Lawrence River and making his way into New France, y'all. And, of course, by taking Louisbourg, he then marches on Quebec, the fortified city, the first big one, on the St. Lawrence River. General Forbes is given the job of marching through Virginia into Pennsylvania, as Braddock had done unsuccessfully, and he will take Fort Duquesne, something no one else had done. In honor of William Pitt, Fort Duquesne will be renamed Fort Pitt and will become Pittsburgh. And in another weird way, y'all, back before Three Rivers Stadium that the Pittsburgh Pirates played in for so much of my young life, the original field was called Forbes Field. Any of y'all ever heard of a baseball player named Roberto Clemente? He was amazing, right? One of the best players I ever got to see personally play. I lived in Puerto Rico as a kid, and of course, being Puerto Rican, he was a big, big hero there. I'm not Puerto Rican. He was, of course, but big, big hero. And sadly, I remember to this day when my mom came to me to let me know that Clemente had been killed on a humanitarian thing. He was taking food and supplies down to Nicaragua after they had a terrible earthquake, and his plane crashed, and Clemente died. And he finished his career, if I'm not mistaken, with an even 3,000 hits. But he still had a lot of good years. Well, anyway, he started off playing in Ford's Field. Later would play in Three Rivers. But anyway, so there you go. So, but then in 1761, something happens that will also have ramifications for Americans, y'all, and that is Spain decides to join this war, and it joins as an ally of France. Now, something that students often forget, because everybody focuses on the money issue, that this war was expensive and the British made us pay debt. But people often forget we wouldn't have probably won the revolution, at least as we did, without the help of the French. Everybody and their mother knows that the French eventually joined us in the Revolutionary War. They forget that Spain also joined us, and the important role of a Spaniard by the name of Bernardo de Galvez in helping America win this war. Galvez, of course, y'all, later will, become famous for a town that's named after him. But that all is going to come later, right? Now, the French, like I said, The French make the decision to, the Spanish make the decision to join up in this war, and it will cost them. But indirectly will help us, because the French and Spanish all will want that territory back after they lose it in this war. And that will be one of the big reasons they join. Not because they had any sympathy towards America and our democracy. All they had kings that were more absolute monarchs than George III ever dreamed of being. What did the French and why did the Spanish join us in this war? To defeat the British and to get some of their land back that they will lose in this war. Now we come to Montcalm versus Wolfe. This is going to be one of the big epic battles in history. I cannot think of any battle, y'all, where the two opposing generals, the main generals, both die in the same battle. You know, usually, y'all, generals are, you know, they're back behind the lines. They're relatively safe. But there was a lot of hatred towards Montcalm. He had been the one, y'all, who had given the British a promise that they would be protected when they left Fort William Henry. And yet what had happened? They had been massacred. So a lot of the Brits really want revenge. Now, one of the two really successful generals that William Pitt sends is young James Wolfe. He had red hair. He was very sickly. In fact, we think he was probably dying of what today would be tuberculosis. Every time he coughed, he spit up blood. Now, these two men will be in the front lines leading their men. They know that the whole future of French America and British America is on this one battle. So they will fight to the death, literally. And I was trying to find something where that could, in a movie, that could maybe pick that up. So I used this scene. See what y'all think. Princess Bride. Now remember, that guy killed his father. So think of the other guy as Montcalm. Think of that guy as Wolfe. This will probably also get blocked off of YouTube. So. It was just like Wolf, man. He kept fighting to the end. That's what it reminds me of, that kind of devotion and fierceness that Wolfe had, y'all. He was literally going to win this no matter what. All right, so the battle, y'all, the battle that in some ways guarantees a United States that speaks English and a United States that is, you know, more British than we are French, is going to be fought in Canada, the Battle of Quebec. Now, this is Quebec City, which was located up here, as you can see it, kind of up in a triangular shaped kind of piece of land along the St. Lawrence River. Now, Wolfe makes his way there and he launches, y'all. This guy really feels like he only has so much time. In a way, it's like I think about President Kennedy, y'all. President Kennedy, I think, knew he was dying. He knew that he had this Addison's disease and his time on Earth wasn't going to be really long. And he really had to get a lot of stuff accomplished. So Wolfe is dying. He's got to take Quebec before winter happens. And so he launches a very, very poorly planned attack, y'all, on the beach. And it's a lot like Private Ryan. They just get wiped out. It's awful. And so, you know, days pass and he's like, what can I do? Well, eventually he learns of this pass that's down here west of Quebec. That what he can do is he can land there and his men can get up on this hill. Now they sneak past the French during the night and they land 4,500 men who climb up these hills at this Pas de Foulon. And they make their way to these plains called the Plains of Abraham. So they're able to fight the French in the open, European style, what the British are best at doing, y'all, on the Plains of Abraham. Now, this may surprise you, but I just so happen to have rare historical footage of this, which we'll see if it actually plays. I'm not doing too well on these today. Let's see. Ooh, there we go.
After 3 months of...
I'm just going to kind of fast forward a little bit here. Here we go.
500 of his men killed or wounded at the Battle of Montmorency.
Montmorency.
Many excellent officers hurt in this foolish business, he writes. Frustrated, Wolfe lashes out.
Now, we're not sure who gave him the information about where to launch this attack. The letters from his diary are torn out.
Partly in return for many insults offered to our own people upon our own frontiers.
So he gets back at him. He's burning French villages, starving out, trying to starve out the French in Quebec.
1,400 houses are torched, but the capital of New France is far from giving up. British forces try to bombard Quebec into submission. The fires that engulf the city produce some of the most horrifying moments of the entire war. But in France, Louis XV considers the struggle for North America just one part of a global war with Britain. Instead of reinforcements, he sends Montcalm encouragement, saying, His Majesty relies completely on
See, the French are more focused on the Caribbean and in Europe.
To save Canada.
Won't send really Montcalm any reinforcements.
Wolfe grows desperate. He has fallen victim to fever, and so have his soldiers. By summer's end, a third of his army is unfit to serve. The British have been shelling the city for 6 weeks. And still, Montcalm will not come out to fight.
My antagonist has wisely set himself up in inaccessible entrenchments.
I just love when they start talking to us.
Spilling a torrent of blood. And that perhaps little notice.
Sure.
Wolfe believes he may soon die.
And he is correct.
Act will bring him disgrace.
Yeah, he promised to come back alive and victorious or dead.
To a path leading up steep cliffs to the plains just west of Quebec. In an audacious nighttime maneuver, he orders 4,500 men to scale the steep cliffs. It takes them less than 5 hours. The element of surprise works. By dawn, the British assemble on the plains of Abraham, just outside the city walls.
Now he instructs his men to put 2 musket balls in their muskets.
Novel formation, spreading his men out in 2 ranks instead of the traditional 3 to cover the half-mile width of the plains.
Rich usually fired in ranks of 3, y'all, where 2 could be reloading while 1 was firing.
But the British line seems especially thin. He believes that a column of troops can smash it.
Now, a lot of the Frenchmen, y'all, aren't professional soldiers. They're militia a lot like we had had.
On the skill and precision of each side's infantry. But as the French advance, order breaks down. Their line becomes ragged.
We have not gone through the bases before. The left was too far in the rear, and the center too far in front.
Company! The French begin to fire before they're within range. The British do not flinch.
Imagine the discipline it takes y'all just to stand there and be receiving fire and to hold off and not shoot yourself. Not shoot yourself, but shoot the enemy.
Wolf waits to the last for maximum effect.
Now, he also used some Scottish guys with two-handed swords, some Highlanders that attacked using their swords and cutting people to pieces.
A British sailor would later note the entire battle lasts no more than 10 minutes. Decimated, the French flee back to the city. 4 days later, they surrender. During the battle, Wolfe is wounded in the wrist and the chest. When asked if he needs a surgeon, he replies, "It is needless. It is all over with me." Wolfe becomes a hero throughout the British Empire, and his death glorified in a succession of idealized
paintings. This is by far the most famous, The Death of Wolfe by Benjamin Webb.
Across the battlefield, Montcalm is shot in the abdomen. The depiction of his death is even more fanciful. In fact, he died not on the battlefield, but in a doctor's house back in town.
All right, but of course, for propaganda purposes, it's got to be a little different. So here's that painting, right? Benjamin West. We've talked about this painting a lot. The Death of Wolfe by Benjamin West. If you zoom in like we saw there, oh, there's the death of Montcalm as well. All right, that's a little bit more accurate, where he's dying in the doctor's house. Benjamin West, there's the guy. All right, remember there's a close-up of Wolfe. Man, he looks awful, like he's dying or something. And a Native American, now remember, I don't think there were necessarily Native Americans fighting for the British here, but Benjamin West, y'all, this painting is supposed to kind of be just representative of the whole war. And some Natives, especially Iroquois, Indians did fight on behalf of the British, and being a proud American, even though Americans weren't really there in this battle, he's included what we think is a member of Rogers Rangers. These were men that amazing soldiers, y'all, that did all kinds of hit and run raids against the Indians and the French. And these guys have become the ancestor of the modern day Army Rangers. And they weren't there, but and then there we get a just some scenes of some of the other guys in this battle. And then there's the final picture again, the death of Wolfe. All right. Now, the treaty that ends this war is called the Treaty of Paris, and it'll be the first of many treaties in Paris with the United States that you guys will need to know, or British North America. 1763, a few years after this battle, because it takes a while to get a peace agreement done. If you look up here and you see the purple that says the French, that's the territory the French had before this war. Watch what happens to the purple. No, that will come later, right? But that'll actually be part of the story when Napoleon gets this area back. Now, notice what happened here with the British, y'all. Their territory expanded from the Appalachians to the Mississippi River. The Spanish got this territory, and that's what becomes the Louisiana Purchase, right? This territory here will go back to the French, and then America will buy it in 1803. So France loses her Canadian possessions. She loses her empire in India. She loses claims to lands east of the Mississippi River, okay? Now, Spain, remember, had been on the French side. Now, the British retake Florida, okay? Now, remember, in the future Revolutionary War, Bernardo de Galvez will help the Spanish retake Florida and, of course, help America in the war. So Spain loses Florida. In consequence for losing Florida and compensation, the French give them this territory of theirs, which, as I said, does ultimately become the Louisiana Purchase. And they also get New Orleans, which makes New Orleans, y'all, all the more interesting because it's now got Spanish, it'll have American, and, of course, it's had the French and African-American culture in that city, making it, you know, truly a diverse city. You know, everybody's always talking about diversity. They truly have had it in their history. England gets all that territory east of the Mississippi River and west of the Appalachians. England gets control of the Caribbean slave trade, sadly, but, you know, they're the ones that make money off of that. And they get basically commercial control of India, which will later become known as the jewel in the crown of England. And the French, y'all, from once having about half of North America, all they're reduced to just having this area of Santo Domingo, the area that today we call Haiti. A lot of these Haitian refugees you guys are seeing coming into the country, if you talk to them, they will speak French. That is their dominant language because that remained the and remains the main language. A lot of them will speak Spanish too because of the connection to the Dominican Republic, and a lot of them have resettled here in South America since one of the last big earthquakes. But you still have that. And also the French, y'all, get to keep two tiny islands, so small. How small are they, Mr. D, that they aren't even on that map? And to this day, these two tiny islands off the coast of Newfoundland still belong to France. So that's all they have, y'all, when it's all over. Now, effects of this war on Britain, okay? First of all, the British Empire greatly increases, and it's going to have to be administered. The other big thing, y'all, is England's national debt. And I don't know why that and I guess I was typing something else there. England's national debt doubles. That's going to cost a lot of money, and they're going to expect the Americans to pay a good chunk of it. And that is going to end salutary neglect. The other thing that happens, y'all, is there's going to be a great deal of contempt for the British for the Americans. Remember, Americans had not paid their fair share of this war. Americans didn't pay anything until they were promised compensation. Americans, it was rumored, traded with the French and the Indians during this war. So the British all develop what can only be called, well, what this guy calls it. Hey, yeah!
I remember you mentioned who?
I hate you.
Hate. Double hate.
Loathe.
And that's kind of what had begun to happen. So the British, y'all, really come to an idea that a major reorganization of the empire is necessary. Now, as you guys will hear Cyndi Lauper sing here, money is going to change everything. This war is expensive. They're going to expect Americans to change to fix it. And that is going to change everything. Come on, Cyndi, sing. Yeah, here we go. Changes everything, and it did. So the effect of this war on American colonists, first of all, the belief that the British soldiers were invincible, y'all, that's going to be shattered, okay? We saw them defeated, you know, under Braddock. Also, lots of bad feelings between colonial militiamen and the British officers who, you know, really ordered them around, treated them like crap. No colonial officer was allowed to have a rank higher than captain, according to the British. So there's some real bad blood. Also, we unite against a common enemy for the very, very first time. First, it was the French. We were all united. And pretty soon, it's going to turn to kind of being united against the British for the way they treated us. All right. Now, these bad feelings are only going to get worse over time. And so this war, y'all, does so much to lay the groundwork for the revolution that we'll be talking about. It really sets a lot of the psychological situation up. for that kind of thing. And it's a socializing experience. It's something they all went through. You know, something like when you guys have a hurricane here, and, you know, it's something that you can talk to other people about that you may not have anything else in common with. And it really makes you cooperate, you know, like neighbors that you didn't maybe meet before, you help each other out. Maybe they got a chainsaw. Maybe you help them get a tree off their driveway or off a car. Maybe you share your generator with them or something. It's a way to get people talking and working together. Also, colonists for the first time begin to, you know, they begin to meet each other. And in a way, the Great Awakening had kind of prepared this. This is the second great of those socializing experiences to bring Americans together. Now, the last thing I want to show today, we'll probably run out of time, but the Americans really did not like the way that the British fought. And I'm going to show you a scene from The Patriot. In this scene, Mel Gibson's son has been kidnapped, and he's going to use his other two sons and himself to try to get the son back. He sets up numerous muskets that have been preloaded. A lot of people didn't like this when it came out because it showed kids using guns. So I don't want any of y'all going home tonight and using muskets, all right? Don't use muskets at home. These young kids are professionals. So we'll end with this today, y'all. All righty, here we go. It's from The Patriot. If you've ever fired one of those muskets, it's kind of interesting because it actually has two explosions. It's like... Notice the Brits saying, come out and fight, come out and fight. And notice they also shot the officers first, which was another tactic the Americans will use in the Revolution. This is actually from the Revolution, but I think it gives you guys a good idea for how helpless you are down there in the woods against guerrilla fighters. Oh, he's got a tomahawk and he knows how to use it. There's the lovely late Heath Ledger. He was famous for playing the Joker before the other guy played the Joker. I liked him a lot, yeah. That Joaquin Phoenix is just kind of scary. All right, check it out. Oh, I hate when that happens. All right, we'll go ahead and stop there, y'all. Slide, which is picks up where the video left off yesterday. Anyway, y'all, Americans really begin to see themselves as equals with the British. The British saw us as inferiors, right, as inadequate soldiers. We really felt that George Washington didn't get really enough props for what he had done. He should have been promoted, especially after Braddock's thing, where he took responsibility for the frontier and everything. And also we begin to see a type of identity developing. As I said, for the first time, some colonials, y'all, left their home colony and journey north or journeyed south. So we start to see where people are beginning to see themselves as something more than just a Virginian or a Carolinian. And though the unity initially is against the French and the Indians, ultimately those colonies are going to unite against the British in a war of independence. And this kind of started all that. Now, if you missed anything, of course, I will have it up there for you guys to watch later. Now, the end of this war, y'all, marks also the end of salutary or benign neglect. Now, remember, for a lot of reasons, mainly because the Brits were busy with their own religious wars and problems and civil wars, the Brits had pretty much left us alone. Salutary neglect, which I compared to your parents leaving you alone, and you learn how to care for yourself and do all that kind of stuff. But with the end of this war, the Brits decide America is going to have to pay its fair share. And so this means we're going to start enforcing laws on the books like the Navigation Act. We're going to stop smuggling. And the British all are going to pass a series of taxes that the Americans have no say in the making of. So what happens to salutary neglect? It's gone. Survey says no more. Also, as I said, the British begin a series of taxing, and you start hearing for the first time cries of taxation without representation is tyranny, or no taxation without representation. And I've often wondered why the British just didn't give America a handful of members of parliament, why they just didn't create a few seats. Perhaps they didn't want to start a precedent where other colonies might also demand to have representatives. Maybe they were afraid that we would grow and our population would need more and more representatives, and we would come to dominate the parliament. I'm not exactly sure. But the Brits, y'all, don't give us that representation. And if they had, y'all, it would have gotten rid of one of the biggest rallying cries and arguments for American independence. Now, Lord Grenville, okay, will be one of the British prime ministers. That's what new PM means. He, of course, convinced the king that the Americans should pay for this war. The Brits were already taxed to death. Their debt had doubled. And you know, you guys hear this kind of thing now. You guys know America is seriously in deep doo-doo with debt, right? I mean, we're in debt trillions of dollars. And yet, everybody wants to have more and more programs. Well, somebody has to pay for those, right? And that means we have to either borrow the money from somewhere, from Americans, other countries, or we have to start taxing an additional group of people. And nobody likes that, right? Nobody likes to see part of their paycheck, part of their savings, or whatever disappear. And especially if you and I don't even have a chance to elect the people doing it. At least you and I, if we don't like the taxes, we can throw the bums out, right? And get somebody else in there. We as Americans didn't really have that right, and it angered us. Now, on the frontier, y'all, you're going to have what becomes known as Pontiac's Rebellion just after the war. It's sort of the last gasp of the Indians. Now, the French have been defeated, but a lot of the Indians, y'all, are getting very upset about all these Americans crossing over the Appalachians and spilling into Indians' land. Now, in the minds of the Americans, they had won this land fair and square by defeating the British, by defeating the French, by defeating the Indians. So they began to leave where they are and look for this new land. Of course, as you and I know, that land is occupied by a lot of Indians. And so it's not long before conflict begins to develop between the two. Now, Pontiac is going to be a great Indian chief who is going to try to unite the Indians, much like King Philip did in New England. Pope in New Mexico. So he goes around and he visits Indians that otherwise might be fighting each other and gets them to agree to fight a common enemy, the British, who have begun to occupy all the forts that the French have left. Now, I looked long and hard to find a picture of Pontiac, and eventually I was able to discover this picture. Oh, that's a Pontiac car, Mr. D. In fact, what type of car is it? It's a Trans Am, baby. See, Trans Am. When Mr. D was in high school, this was the car every teenage boy wanted. These were awesome cars. In fact, these Pontiacs, and see, this is my way to trick y'all into remembering Pontiac. Pontiac sadly is out of business, was used in this movie. Smokey and the Bandit 1, Smokey and the Bandit 2, and Smokey and the Bandit 3. Bandits were the guy who's fleeing. Smokies were considered cops. We just got all the good scenes with the Trans Am. Yeah, that was like a Firebird, wasn't it? That he used in that, a Pontiac Firebird. I mean, they were similar, y'all. Camaro, Pontiac Firebird, Pontiac Trans Am. Check it out. Now, that's before CGI, y'all. They really did that stuff. You know, in movies now, you're not sure what's real and what did they fake, right? But pretty awesome scene, Pontiac Firebird. But the real Pontiac, y'all, not as exciting looking, right? There he is, going around, gathering these Indians together, telling them that they share this one enemy and they need to work together to drive them out. So who was Pontiac? He's an Indian chief from the Ottawa tribe. He came really close, y'all, to driving the British out of that territory. And for a while, he actually did gain Indians some territory, but it just doesn't last long. Eventually, Americans will continue to cross over. When there's an American Revolution, the Indians will back the British. And of course, then when they lose, they're really out. I mean, they start losing land like crazy after backing the British in the war. They don't have a lot of luck picking the winning side, I hate to say.
Yep. That picture of Pontiac, that's like, I'll excite.
You like that picture?
Look at him. Rip.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty awesome. Well, it's going to look even better when you see, that's right, rare historical footage. Okay. Yeah.
This is going to come as fast.
Exactly. You're not going to see, I mean, I had to get another drive to hold all this rare footage. Not going to see it anywhere else. Now, so what this picture shows you, y'all, is where Pontiac's War, as it's sometimes called, Pontiac's Rebellion, takes place. To show you how bad my humor was as a kid, I thought the Indians named the Kickapoos, that was the funniest thing in the world. Kind of sad, isn't it? But all these places, y'all, that have the fire on them, these were British forts that the Indians took, including Michilimackinac. Okay, Michilimackinac. Now, this fort, y'all, which is in a beautiful place, by the way, if you ever get up to Michigan, and also a very romantic area up there at Mackinac. They don't allow any horses up there, y'all. They don't allow any cars. You have to ride around in horses and have buggies and stuff, and it's a really kind of cool romantic place. But anyway, great for honeymoons. But the thing is, y'all, the Indians took all of these places. Detroit did not fall, but nearly did. And Fort Pitt, modern day Pittsburgh, did not fall. And this war gets really ugly. Eventually, you know, several hundred British soldiers get killed. Several thousand American colonists are killed, kidnapped by the Indians. And they came really close, y'all, to driving us out. Okay. By us, I mean the American colonists in that area. Now, I'm going to show you a clip here, some rare historical footage with Pontiac. It's some of the worst acting you'll ever see, but nevertheless, here you go.
Bonjour, Luigi Nishnar, Red Dog. Brethren, the English have treated us with much disrespect.
They stopped giving them gifts because they didn't need to anymore with the French.
An Ottawa war chief named Pontiac uses powerful religious ideas to stir his fellow Indians to action.
The Master of Light took Nawin by the hand and gave him a fancy hat.
Pontiac tells them of the visions of a Delaware Indian prophet named Nawin and his encounter with their creator, the Master of Life.
The Master of Life spoke to him. This land that I created was for you. And no one else. As for those who came to trouble your lands, Nowlin said, drive them out.
Make war upon
Make
them.
Make war upon them.
War bells spread Pontiac's message. Indians who once played the two European empires against each other now band together against the British. This would be a new war.
My daughter used to play lacrosse, so I always liked to see. It was a they did the old throw the ball over the wall trick.
1763, warriors from the Ojibwe and Sauk nations are engaged in a heated game of bagatelle, or as the French call it.
Indian lacrosse was serious, shall we? People used to get wounded, break legs, and arms.
The game is entering its third day outside Fort Michilimackinac on the northernmost reaches of modern-day Michigan.
Now, the accounts I heard said the gates were closed.
We know of the game that day from the writings of one of the first English traders to venture into the territories, Alexander Henry.
I did not go to see the match, which was to be played outside the fort, but rather employ myself in writing letters.
The British had no idea why this game of lacrosse was really being played here. They didn't realize that Amherst's reforms had insulted and enraged the native people.
He'd stopped giving gifts to the Indians.
A very important piece of news. All the Indians knew that a month earlier, Pontiac had inspired an Indian attack on Fort Detroit.
That's a wampum bell.
It was a sign of things to come.
Now watch what they do.
And now it comes to Michilimackinac.
Oh, mister, I threw my ball over your yard accidentally over your fence. I need to come get my ball. And you notice the Indian women have the tomahawks and the knives. Ow! Oh! That's kind of hurt. That's unusual.
Going instantly to my window, I saw a group of Indians in the fort.
I noticed the French Canadians back there, y'all.
Every Englishman they found.
Indians don't attack them, just the British soldiers.
Dying were writhing and shrieking under the knife and tomahawk. I was shaken, not only with horror, but with fear. I found many of the French Canadian inhabitants calmly looking on.
The attack at Michilimackinac would be repeated as one British outpost after another falls to the Indians, and this new war spreads across the land.
Under cool effects here, y'all, watch this.
The British managed to lose all but three of their major forts in the backcountry. The Indians, inspired by Pontiac. Hundreds of soldiers and thousands of civilians are killed or taken captive.
Now, this got so bad, how bad did it get? That the British actually considered, y'all, I need to remove this so you can see that. The British actually considered this. We don't have any proof that they did it, but there's an allegation that's pretty shocking. The allegation was General Amherst wrote about the possibility of getting blankets of smallpox victims and giving them to the Indians so that smallpox could be spread around. I mean, an early type of bio warfare. Hard to imagine they would consider doing something to the French or to the Spanish like that, but they did consider it doing to the Indians. We don't know if it happened. But it did, at least the idea was floated. Pretty scary thought when you think about it. Now, Pontiac's rebellion does, however, ultimately fail. Pontiac is killed for a bounty on his head by fellow Indians. But the British, y'all, do come up with what they think is a fair solution. They draw a line down the Appalachian Mountains here, an imaginary line, and they basically say, you Americans, you stay on this side of the Appalachians. You Indians, you stay on this side of the Appalachians. And hopefully this will stop any more rebellions. I mean, the British, y'all, they had fought this war for 9 years. Then they had to settle Pontiac's Rebellion. They were tired of it, like Americans are tired of Afghanistan. They want to come home. They want to stop spending the money. And so to prevent another rebellion, hopefully to solve this Indian problem, they decide to do what they think is a long-term solution. But of course, Americans very quickly, y'all, came to dislike this idea. Americans think that they have won this war against the French, against the Indians, and they should be allowed to move in and take this land and build their farms and settle there. And so one of the best ways to get Americans to do something is, of course, to tell them not to do something. And so about as, you know, before the ink was dry on this line, y'all, Americans were crossing that line and going over into that territory, which would result in more Indian conflict. So what's the colonial response? I don't know if you guys have seen many mafia movies. You've seen many movies of guys in New York, but they often say, forget about it. That's kind of how the Americans were. Forget about it. We'll go ahead and stop there, y'all. You guys have a good day. I'll post this later, Ray. All right, and the last thing I want to have up here, y'all, ignore the stuff about Monty Python's and the Holy Grail. That is the stuff about airspeed velocity of a European swallow. What is your quest? What is your name? But I do want to put these up here. These are a couple of times in the last 20 years that there have been questions about the French and Indian War. As you can see, they mainly focus on the results of the war and the causes, or not so much the causes, but the results. Your final Jeopardy question tomorrow will be along these lines, where you got to talk about the effects. How did it change relations between the British and the colonists? And I would probably know the Indians as well. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and I'll leave that, or you can freeze that if you want to make sure you get that written. But remember, tomorrow, Jeopardy, please study tonight. And that'll about do it here, y'all. Let me go ahead.